Kara, Facebook is a topic that you've been writing about mm-hmm. in the last few days.
Yeah.
I just got to ask you what the how much reaction you got to your initial column in the Times.
Oh, quite a lot. I think I was sort of voicing some things a lot of people feel and about the things, the price we're paying for social networks. And it's something I've talked about here a lot, as you know, Carl. This idea of responsibility, this idea of accountability, the idea of being more mature when you're thinking about these things. And then you looked at Apple today making a decision on InfoWars rather clearly. And so I talk about this idea of that you can make value judgments at these companies without abrogating these values that you also have around free speech and ability to communicate.
Kara, you've made the argument, it seems to me in this column, that mm-hmm. Facebook and other social networks like it are not, on balance, good for society. Mark Zuckerberg keeps making the argument, yeah, there are bad actors out there, but overall, look at all we've done for you. We've connected the world.
And yeah.
You're arguing that it's not necessarily on balance good.
No, what I'm arguing is that it's not all good, and I think that's the story we've had for far too long. And this damage that's happened has a price for society, and we're all learned as these social networks, and not just Facebook, it's also Google's YouTube, it's also Twitter. As these they sort of struggle to figure this out, society is damaged, and there's a price for it. And that's all I was saying. And I used a pretty sharp term, which is digital arms dealers. And I don't mean to say they do it on purpose. It's that it's not thought out enough. These policies aren't thought out enough, and they're and we're seeing the effects of that now as these things become so central to our lives. And, you know, the same thing around this financial story in the Wall Street Journal. How much information do we want these giant, essentially private companies run by essentially single people to have? And I think that's a good thing to debate as a society, and it's an important one.
And Kara, just to sort of dig into that point a little bit more, I mean, coming mm-hmm. off the heels of your podcast and what was a really fascinating conversation with Mark Zuckerberg, it seems to me one of the key, I guess, sort of factors coming out of that op-ed in the New York Times is this idea that maybe he's still somewhat naive or still sort of looking at glass half full in terms of how much power he has at the
right.
helm of Facebook.
Well, you know, if you listen to that podcast, I tried several times to get him to talk about how he feels about that pressure and if he's thinking widely about it. And I do believe he is. One of the things at the end, you know, he's been having these dinners with, I don't know who they are. I'm trying to figure out who they are. But I'm assuming ethicists and philosophers and others to talk about these very important issues around free speech, around false information, about the impact, impact of using these things on loneliness, all kinds of things I'm sure he's talking about. And my whole goal was to, like, listen, these people have got to get educated really quickly because society is paying the price at this point. And the question is, the decisions they make are going to have a great impact on a vast majority of the human race. And so I want them to be more responsible. And I don't think that's a big ask, as far as I'm concerned.
Kara, we know the damage that was done to the stock in the wake of the quarter. Mm-hmm. And we don't often talk about price action with you specifically. But, I mean, do you think that's about the street reacting to just raw metrics, or do you think they're starting to wrap their arms around the puzzle that the company has in front of them?
No, I don't think Wall Street cares about anything but money. So, no, I think they're just, I think that, look, user growth, I think this will impact their business as these places, not just Facebook again, I don't want to just focus on them, Twitter, all the others, as they become cesspools of humanity, people aren't going to use them as much. And so, and at the same time, the tentacles are just, like, growing and growing. And I don't mean to be alarming, but if they have this great responsibility and we trust them with our financial information and everything else, every piece of information, we've got to think hard about what those responsibilities are when they get that awesome responsibility to have all that information. And if the right people are in the right place and they're asking the right questions and putting the safeguards in place. And again, it's not that they shouldn't thrive as businesses, but that they should be thinking hard because of the responsibility they have. So I don't think it's the hardest thing in the world to grok.
Facebook, Twitter, Google, also Spotify. Is there
All
any company
them.
That you think is doing Apple. A good job in terms of how they're addressing this and tackling this so far?
Well, today, Apple had the announcement out InfoWars. It just took them off the platform. It took a long time, but they actually just removed this information from the platform. And people can scream about the free speech issues, and believe me, I'm a First Amendment backer to the highest. But the fact of the matter is, freedom from, it's an old expression, I think it's freedom of speech does not mean freedom from consequence. And so if it's a government situation, it's very different. But a company, if there is something on their platform that they think is not, it doesn't mean you can't be taken off the platform. And Apple is not the government, or Facebook is not the government. And so what's interesting is what choices these platforms are going to make about what's residing on their platform and what responsibility they have. And they have to think hard. And I think Apple today made a great decision. I just do. So,
Kara, we didn't get to talk to you last week when Apple hit a $1 trillion market cap, and they did hit a new record high today. I saw a list of, we talked about this, some of the lessons from that valuation. One was that hardware matters still, despite software eating the world, that you can get a valuation like that without catering to all price points by staying at the high end. But the third one was argued that privacy gets a multiple. And I wonder if you think some of that number has happened because of the stance Cook has taken.
I think it's added in there. I don't think it's the number one thing. I think it's just a great product and people like it. Like, I think that's pretty much the basics of it. And it's beautifully done. And they make some missteps, and there's some like issues they have, like the battery or whatever pops up. But the fact of the matter is, over a very, very long time, this group of executives, this company, has hit it on all cylinders in their products, and that's paid off over time with this valuation, which apparently is quite low. If you think about the multiple, the P.E. ratio and things, which is kind of fascinating if you think about that. Yeah. And so I think it's just a really great product. And the thing, again, like with Facebook and anything else, the thing that's going to bring them down is a bad product or a product that people don't want to use. And I think that's what you have to be thinking of all the time. And in Apple's case, they have a lot of taste and they have a lot of values that they're bringing to it and trying to stick to. And again, they don't always succeed. But overall, they succeed more than other people, I guess. That's how you
would put it. And they've got enough cash to sustain a lot of time without a huge hit product. But a couple of things struck me about Apple hitting this $1 trillion market cap. One was, unlike so many other big companies with big valuations, they haven't done any huge revenue-adding acquisitions. They did this largely organically, and they did it through distribution, the retail strategy, which seemed crazy at the time, but has paid huge dividends for them, and also vertical integration, which has allowed them to extract maximum profit from their product line, from PA Semi on the chips end, through tying the hardware and software together. Kara, a lot of people, me included, when the iPhone first came out, thought, boy, this can't work. Microsoft and Intel have shown that you need to focus on doing one piece of it and letting an ecosystem have the rest. Apple said, uh-uh.
Well, it's called taste, right? They're selling their taste to the human race, essentially. I mean, if you think about it, this is what we want to offer, and this is what we have to give, and this is what, if you like it, you like it. If you don't, you don't. And so I think more often they've been right than wrong, which is always a good thing in life, you know, in general. And in terms of the products, they work beautifully. I like it. You know, I spend a lot of money on Apple, and the other day I was in the store. I'm just thinking of my son. He was using Spotify forever, but he just switched to Apple Music. And when it first started, I think I was thinking he's never going to leave Spotify, but he just did because the product got good. Like, it's just that's what's interesting to me is that, like, the product gets good and then people use it. And I don't think that's that difficult a thing to think about. It's very hard to execute. I think that's in the end. And they're beautiful executors of these kind of things and deserve this valuation. And the others are coming, I guess. Google, Amazon will probably get up in those numbers relatively soon, too, in the $1 trillion club, I guess.
Yeah, Kara, you just took the question right out of my mouth. We had Ann Winblad on Squawk Box this morning, and she made the point that she would have expected Amazon to hit $1 trillion before Apple. So I guess my question to you is this the first of the U.S. companies to hit $1 trillion market cap?
Oh, yeah. Oh, I think they're all going to do that. You know, I think they're all going to get to those levels because they're so integral to our lives, which again brings us back to the beginning. They have enormous responsibility if they have this much power and this much financial power. And so the people that run these companies have got to just think harder about the products they make and the impact they have on society, whether it be all kinds of things, whether it creates addiction, whether it's stealing your information, whether it's privacy. These companies with these $1 trillion valuations all have responsibilities well beyond just what Wall Street wants from them. And I think the society, and especially millennials, expect that going forward.